So when we look at how we can actually take action at Geotab to make sure that these improvements are made, we're going to go through a few slides that might look like they're kind of high school, but they're supposed to be funny. So we have the content. We know that the content is our go-to material. However, we can acknowledge that it's not always kept up to date, it's not polished, and it's not always easy to find what you're looking for. That's going to be a big focus. As we scale up Geotab, we hire so many talented engineers and people who have hands-on experience and industry experience. There's an opportunity for us to actually use our product and kind of try and break it as much as possible before we release it to the public. Too many times have there been cases where there's feedback from the field, there's something that's developed, and then the developed piece goes back to the field and there's a problem again. We need to reduce that kind of poor interaction and make sure that Geotab's providing quality products. Lastly, with those two things in mind, we can provide toolkits. So actual tailored toolkits to the type of solution that you're developing, something that points you to the right APIs, to the right methods, the things that you should really be focusing on to build something great. So if we look at the first step, refreshing the content, it's quite interesting. It has never been someone's role, someone's primary role at Geotab, to actually maintain the SDK. It's always been, okay, if I have time for a developer, I'm going to jump in and I'm going to make the changes that someone's requesting. No one's actually owned it, which is kind of crazy. So there's an opportunity for that gap to actually be filled. And that's where the solutions engineering department comes in. We're the ones who have that outside world context. We understand how the customers and how the partners are actually using our products. And we understand the inner workings and the capabilities of the engineering and development teams in Geotab. We're the ones who can make the two ends meet and make sure that everything is done properly. Once we have that context, we have an understanding of how the products are used, we can actually go ahead and make sure that the documentation is updated, polished, and probably most difficultly would be getting those kinds of personal experiences and the gotchas that are in all of our minds onto the forefront. If someone comes up to me and they want to integrate a tire pressure monitoring system, for example, I have five other experiences which I can leverage, and I can use my knowledge, and I can make sure that I don't hit the same stumbling blocks that I did the first couple times. But if it's someone new to that topic, the process is slower and it's more difficult to integrate. So we want to make sure that the content is available right out front and partners have everything that they need to effectively get started properly. This would all be driven through a feature request process, which many of our resellers are already familiar with. Changes to MyGeotab, changes to firmware for supporting new engine data, new IOX requests, whatever the case might be, that goes through a vetting cycle internally at Geotab. So hands-on in-house. So we have the development teams and engineers, and they're the ones that sit at their desks and they don't get to get out too much. They kind of are stuck there doing two great things. They should be always creating new features and fixing bugs. What happens though, as I previously mentioned, they don't have that exposure to how these features and bugs are actually being tested and used in the field. So we need that intermediary team, and that's called the integrations team. The integrations team is a combination of solutions engineers and support SDK team members who take that individual component that was just created as part of a developer's sprint cycle, let's say, and we actually put it into a testing environment, into a simulation that better resembles how that feature will be used in the field. So that's the importance of kind of making sure that we have better refined products, the experience between Geotab, our partners, and our end users is cleaner, and you know, we're saving time and pain, essentially. So on top of those considerations, I've had this idea, and the idea for how we can get to the top of this pyramid, which is the most consistent and friendliest experience when you're working with Geotab. Every integration starts with an architecture decision. So one company comes to another, technical folk will get together once the business people decide that it's viable, and you have to kind of step through to understand what this integration will look like and who's responsible for making what components. today, in that tire pressure monitoring example that I had, my knowledge, my previous experiences will make me very good at integrating tire pressure monitoring systems. But if someone comes to me with a routing solution, I'm not the best guy, and I don't have the knowledge and that experience in my mind to really help push that along as quickly as it should. So what we can do is we can break it down. We can say, we have a viable integration at the top. It makes business sense. I don't have another solution for it. We need this product. Now I continue down the tree, and I see, is this a software solution? Is it a custom device, perhaps, that replaces the Go device? Is it a hardware add-on that's going to connect to the Go device? And as I continue to filter and I continue to isolate what the actual solution is going to look like, I'm left with a very descriptive scope of work. So it's clear of what the solution will have, who is responsible for developing which aspects, and that ultimately leads to what we'll call a resource toolkit. For example, if I have a camera partner, they have a well-renowned camera solution, it does not connect to the Go device, it has a standalone application in the cloud, and we want to make the clouds talk together between Geotab and the camera partner, we can tailor a package that says, you know what, you're going to want to use the exception event APIs, and you're going to want to call at this frequency, and you want to make sure you cater for this particular user experience. So that's all something that can be provided to partners to make sure that they're getting everything they need right off the bat. It all adds up to, again, that consistent experience, which is the goal. Taking a step back into my admin now. So it's interesting, but my experience with so many partners over the years has basically got me believing that there needs to be a true administrative portal for partners. They can develop a solution, they can start to work with resellers, and once that solution's actually launched, they don't have visibility into what is going on with their customers. Common questions: who do I contact for support? Is the server down or is my integration broken? What firmware is this Go device on? And what firmware do I need it to be on for my integration to actually work with it? This is all stuff that is technically impossible for a partner to get at to by themselves. So the goal is, how can we actually improve the partner experience to help themselves and to better understand how they can improve their own solutions to get at more customers? A quick look into some of the features to keep an eye out for. Standardized ERP accounts. So ERP accounts are the way that Geotab identifies our resellers. Every reseller has a unique ID. We mirror this over to the partner portal. So every partner has an ERP, and therefore they are properly identified within our environment. And when it comes to supporting that partner, we at least now have some context about who they are, what type of solution they have, and what their history is with Geotab. Partner support ticketing. Just like resellers can log into MyAdmin or call into the help desk, we want to replicate that for the partners as well. Up until now, and probably for the next couple months until this is implemented, partners typically reach out to the only people that they know at Geotab, the ones that they trust and the ones that help them build an integration. As such, if you're someone who's helped a partner build an integration 50 times, you now are theoretically supporting 50 partners as you're onboarding 10 more partners this year. It's just not adding up to be scalable. Global authentication, so actually using your single set of MyAdmin credentials to authenticate to a MyGeotab database. This is available today, so if you're a MyAdmin user, you can use those credentials to get into a MyGeotab database so long as your user account exists there. We want to replicate that for service accounts, which are used for data extraction. Lastly, analytics. So a theme, obviously, a big part of this show. Data companies, or companies are becoming data companies. Data is the new oil. All these kinds of themes basically sum up to what we would encourage our partners to adopt. If you can't see how your solution is performing, if you can't see the last time that your customer accessed your add-in, or you can't see how many devices you sold that are connected to Go devices this month, you're kind of running blind and you can't make good business decisions. So bringing in the tools, not only the APIs, but also a friendlier partner portal in MyAdmin, will allow for that to happen. So last segment here on deeper integrations. What does it really mean to have a deeper MyGeotab integration? It's kind of a buzzword that's been going around. So the easiest way to improve the user experience is to implement a single sign-on. So essentially, the same way that any one of us could use our Facebook credential or our Google credential to log into some third-party application very easily with a single click, that's the type of stuff that we want to implement for Geotab as well. In the context of Geotab, this directly applies to a user's experience with add-ins. So if I'm a MyGeotab user, I sign in, I'm in my database, I can click on a partner's add-in without having to enter my credentials and automatically enter that solution and see the data that is applicable to me. So Geotab recognizes the importance of this. There's tons of partners at this show, which I've talked to, that want this and feel the need for it as well. We are working on supporting an industry standard for SSO, for outbound authentication. So taking a look at the integration landscape, if you want to build something into MyGeotab today, you have a few options. You can do data syncing, pushing and pulling of data. For example, you wanted to pull odometer and engine hours into your maintenance application to drive your oil changes. Secondly, you can build a custom page or button add-in using our lifecycle. Third, you can have an iframed add-in, some web application that you've already developed, bring it into, fully into MyGeotab, and unify the experience there. And fourth is the concept of a deeper integration. So a deeper integration is actually a new suite of APIs that very few people have probably been exposed to. These APIs actually allow for an added flexibility to the native pages of MyGeotab. So we're no longer talking about embedding a new icon into the MyGeotab portal underneath the map or underneath the vehicles page. We're actually talking about augmenting or enriching the content on a MyGeotab native page. And I'll show you what that kind of means. So anyone who's interested in a better user experience should certainly be looking into this, and we encourage all partners to start looking at the documentation and finding ways that we can make this deeper integration happen. It's currently exclusive to the live map and the trips history pages within MyGeotab. So for a bit of a joke, as I was waiting for our flight from Toronto to San Diego on Sunday, we had a 5-hour delay, so I was sitting on the plane, pulled up my presentation and started adding some slides. And I was trying to explain what the concept of a deeper integration was to one of my sales colleagues. She didn't quite get it and offered that I should include an analogy. So this sandwich on the left, I was hungry at the time and I decided to choose a sandwich. This sandwich on the left is a decent looking sandwich. I would take it any day of the week. It looks pretty good, it's appetizing. And interestingly, that is my view of today's MyGeotab map page. When I pull up the map, I can see where my vehicles are, I can get my trips history if I want. It's pretty good. However, over time, my appetite's going to evolve. I'm going to get curious for more flavors, different toppings, and I want to get my hands on this sandwich. So this sandwich is the enhanced sandwich. It's going to fill me, it's going to taste better, presumably. And I can't wait to get it. The interesting part is that it is still the MyGeotab map page. It is the same MyGeotab map page. So getting from the delicious sandwich on the left to the enhanced sandwich on the right, I need some fancy add-ons. And these are sauces and salsas and whatever else. That is actually the new suite of deeper add-ins. The key is we're dealing with the same MyGeotab page. We are just enriching the content of that single page. Quick run through of the actual services that are available for these deeper add-ins. These deeper add-ins have access to the web browser's local storage. They can get the page state. Probably most importantly, and some of the features that we've seen in the show over the past couple days, they can subscribe to events. So the add-in can actually tell when the user is moving their mouse, hovering their mouse over specific areas, or clicking on things. The tooltip that pops up when you hover over a vehicle or a zone on the map, that's actually customizable. Today, you see things like the vehicle name, the weather, the speed. With these deeper add-ins, you can actually manipulate the content that's presented in that MyGeotab tooltip. The map, you can actually set the bounds and zoom in and out. And lastly, you can customize the action list, which pops up when you click on a MyGeotab element like a vehicle or zone. So I'll step through a couple examples. Here we have an example developed by one of Geotab's intern students. Might be a bit difficult to see, but very clearly on the left side, we have a MyGeotab map page. Everyone should be familiar with that. We see a square, which represents a vehicle stopped. We have a hover, indicating some info about the vehicle. But on the right-hand side, we actually have a panel. There's this new real estate, which is open for developers to essentially get into. What happens here in this example, I have my map, I click on a vehicle, and this extended content, this vehicle information pulled from multiple Geotab APIs is presented in the screen. So the add-in has subscribed to the click event on the vehicle, which then triggers a series of API calls to the database to populate the current status of the vehicle. Very kind of simple framework example, but this is the kind of stuff that we're presenting and we're providing to the public to build on as a framework. In another similar example, we have a live trip history. So we're all familiar with seeing a vehicle moving on a map. We have the triangle as it continues eastbound there. And there's actually a tail, which is configurable based on a sliding bar. So if I'm someone who's just curious to see where this vehicle came from in the last 10 minutes, I can scroll to 10 minutes on the slider bar on the right-hand side and actually get the responding tail to show me where that vehicle came from. So those are the kinds of ideas that we really want partners and customers and resellers to help us generate more of, come up with new ideas for how you'd like to see data actually merged together and enriched within the Geotab system. If you have any thoughts or comments, happy to take those after the presentation. I'll hand it over to my colleague Steve to continue on with a look into some of the new tools for platform partners.
Thank you, Jason.
I'm kind of hungry. I can go for one of those sandwiches right now. Okay, so I'm going to talk about some of the new tools that we have for platform partners, specifically in the platform as a service area. These came about since I started Geotab based on common threads in my interactions with our partners. Before we get into those, a bit of an announcement here. One is that Geotab is now willing to license the curve algorithm for use by our partners. For those who don't know what the curve algorithm is, it's essentially the algorithm used in our firmware to determine which points are important and should be sent to the server versus those that can be ignored. There's a link here on this slide which will actually provide an article with a lot more information on the curve algorithm, and that also has Neil Cause doing a video presentation, so it gives you a good understanding of how that works. Now, in terms of licensing, it's going to be for third-party integrators, essentially wanting to put their device data into the Geotab platform. There's going to be no cost for the license, and it's going to be handled on a case-by-case basis. So if you're interested in this, then you can contact us. By us, I don't mean Jason, myself. You would go through your partner account manager to get that conversation going. Now, before we look at the tools, just a quick overview of the API-only plan. So this is for integrators who are really wishing to only extract the device, engine, IOX data from the Geotab platform to use it in their own systems. When this option is chosen, there's a number of restrictions. First and foremost is no access to the MyGeotab user interface. There's also a number of other restrictions, essentially meaning that you have no access to the value-added processes and objects that Geotab adds to the device data. This slide here shows you a summary of the MyGeotab SDK methods and objects that are available when on the API-only plan. So if you were to compare this with the SDK documentation, you'll see that there's it's somewhat limited in terms of the number of methods that you can use and also the objects that you're able to work with. So this can make it a little bit challenging for partners who are new to this to try to figure out what they're allowed to do, how to do it, all those sorts of things. So what's been developed here for the API-only plan is a number of different tools that can help you get started, make it easier to work with the SDK. So all of these ones that I'm going to mention here were developed in .NET using the .NET API. And they basically will help you to work legally and more easily within the constraints of the API-only option. The first one here we'll talk about is the Customer Onboarding Starter Kit. Essentially, it's a console application, so it's self-contained. And it really consists of two different utilities that will help with onboarding new customers when you don't have access to the MyGeotab user interface. The first utility within this application will allow you to essentially create a database through the SDK. And then it'll add an administrative or service account for later use to connect to that database. And then you can upload a list of devices. So if you've got a new customer and you have a bunch of devices you're going to ship out, you can have the device serial numbers in a CSV file. This utility will help you create the database and then load those devices into the database. And in that case, you'll have the device serial numbers, and the name will also be the serial number at that point. Now, once the devices have been installed, at that point, you might actually be able to associate a name, vehicle 1, vehicle 2, vehicle 3, with the serial numbers, and potentially you might also want to set the driver feedback options for those individual devices. So the second utility allows you to do that, again, through a CSV file. You populate the various fields, and then you can use this utility to load that. It will update any devices that exist in a database, and also if there's any new devices, you can run the same utility, it'll add those in. Next thing we'll talk about is the Geotab Data Only Plan API. And so what this really is it's a DLL for the non-technical people in the room. Really what it is a wrapper around the .NET API. And what it does is it exposes methods and objects that allow you to work with the API while complying with the restrictions imposed by the API only option. So it makes it easier to work with the .NET API essentially. One thing that's important to note, though, is that it uses the standard Geotab objects. So if you're looking at the SDK reference and you see the different objects, device, user, et cetera, those are the objects that are being used here. So if you work with this, you don't need to start learning a whole new object model. This slide here just compares working with the MyGeotab API on the left versus the data-only plan API, which is, again, a wrapper. So with the MyGeotab API, you have a small number of methods, and they each work with a large number of different entities. When you work with the data-only plan API, those get wrapped up so that you actually have individual methods that are tailored to the entities that you're allowed to work with. And so there's a listing of a few of those different entity types. This slide shows the various methods that are available in the data-only plan API. Just to note, we're not going to go through all of these here, but the color coding here helps you to map these back to the MyGeotab API. So the light blue color in the names, that really shows you the objects, the MyGeotab objects that you're working with. And then the cell shading helps to map back to the methods in the MyGeotab API. So for example, the yellow cells, those are all add methods. And then you've got green is get, and then get feed is in orange, et cetera, et cetera. So to go along with this data only plan API, there's an example solution that's been created. So rather than just giving you this API and you having to figure it out, this solution is available. It's up on GitHub, and it contains two different projects. One is basically a set of basic implementation examples. So if you want to know how to use this method, it's very simple, self-contained, you know. You can copy and paste this and modify it. And then the other one is a more comprehensive example called a fleet monitor. And this is an example of an application, how you're able to harness the data feeds and some business logic, put it all together, and it could serve as the basis for the development of new integrations, especially useful for people that are new to the SDK. This just shows the user interface. Again, it's a console application, no fancy UI, because we don't want to complicate the example with UI logic. So we just keep it to the basics. Here you have a menu of the different methods in the API. And so if you want to run those, you just enter the number and hit enter, and it'll run that method and then bring you back to the menu. Here's an example of the code for any developers in the audience. You can see this is just one of the methods in there. You see very few lines of code, just gets straight to the point. The more interesting one here is the fleet monitor example. So in a nutshell, what it does is it uses data feeds to track vehicles and output data to files. It's configurable, so you can track specific vehicles using their IDs, or you can dynamically track vehicles as data is reported through the data feeds. It captures GPS data, otherwise known as log records, for all the tracked vehicles. And you can also optionally track any number of diagnostics, which includes status data or fault data. You're able to start the feeds at the current date time or at a past date or time, or using the feed tokens. And you have some other options, like specifying the feed interval every 30 seconds, every minute, etc. And you can also control the output folder and maximum file size. This is an object model. I'm not going to get into a lot of detail in here other than point out the colors. So if anyone downloads this solution and wants to look at it, there's a file with a class within each of these, within a solution, and each of these is a file, essentially. This shows you what those are for. So the green ones are really your business logic. The yellow ones are the data objects, so when you pull data from the feed, they get stored in those objects. Then the reddish ones are config file output files, and the blue represents the Geotab data objects that are used in the solution. So anyone technical can look at this and get a bit of an understanding how it works. Now in this next series of slides, I'm not going to go into business logic, but I'll just give a quick overview. So this is, again, a different representation of what we just saw on the previous slide. Important to note that the MyGeotab API is really at the heart of everything. So this is all built on top of it. Then we have the data-only plan API, which is that DLL that we've created for you to use in your projects. And that basically wraps the MyGeotab API. So essentially any call you make to the data-only plan API gets translated under the hood into a call to the MyGeotab API. We have our config file, so that's where you're able to set all the options that I mentioned earlier. And then we have feed result token files. And so for anyone who's not familiar with the process of using the data feeds, essentially it's a polling mechanism. So in order to capture live data from the Geotab system, what you're going to do is you're going to use this get feed method. The first time you call it, you might, for example, start at the current date and time, and you want to get log records, so you'll execute the call. It'll give you back a bunch of records, if any, and you'll also get a two value, so that's a token. Then when you make the next call, 30 seconds later, for example, you're going to supply that two value as the from value in your next call, and then it'll come back with new results, anything that's come in to the system since the last call, and you just keep going so on and so forth. By storing these tokens in files, as opposed to just keeping them in memory, that allows you, as an example here, to continue where you left off if the application stops for any reason. So let's say your computer dies, or you just stop it and you want to continue later. You can just configure it to start based on the feed token. Next time it starts up, it'll just grab those and continue where it left off, so you don't lose any data. The output data in this case gets written to CSV files. So again, we want to keep this simple, not start interfacing with databases or other systems. So our output is really CSV files. In reality, you would be taking this feed data, potentially writing it to your database or sending it to some third-party system through an API. The program within the application, that's basically the starting point of the application. So when you get in there, it's going to ask for, again, a console application, so it's going to ask you for MyGeotab credentials. It's going to authenticate those. It's creating that data-only plan instance. It's going to load the configuration file, do some validation, and create an output folder. And then it's going to create what's called a database worker, which then handles all the business logic. So the database worker here, that's really the core of this example application, and it contains, like I said, most of the business logic. So it's going to determine whether or not to use the status data or fault data feeds, depending on what you've configured. So if you're only looking for an odometer fuel level, for example, there's no fault data included there. So no point to have a fault data feed running, which is just wasting API calls, resources, network traffic, et cetera. So it's intelligent enough to do that. And it also manages the feed processor, which is really what actually executes the feed calls. The feed processor here essentially retrieves the data via data feeds, and it manages the caches of lookup data, and then it hydrates the objects coming in from the feeds. I'll get into a little bit more on that. You're basically going to have one data feed for log records, that's your GPS data. So for any vehicle you're tracking, you're going to be getting GPS data. And then you're optionally going to have additional feeds for status data and fault data, depending which diagnostics you're tracking. And then there's also additional data feeds for the lookup data that's used to hydrate the objects coming back through your feeds. So I'll get into a little bit of an explanation here, because this is something that's come up a lot in dealing with partners and customers that are trying to understand how the feeds work. So in order to be efficient, Geotab minimizes the amount of data that we're going to send over the wire. So when you call a feed, for example, in this case, this is a fault data record coming in, the child objects in there are going to only have the ID properties populated. So on the center table there, you'll see that you've got the one row highlighted green. That's the ID of the diagnostic. All the other properties you see have the red text, which says null. Those aren't populated. So if you need to use that, what you do is you have a cache of those diagnostics. So you actually have fully populated diagnostics sitting there within this application. And when the feed data comes in, you basically match up on the ID and you replace the empty one with the fully populated one. And then that gives you the result you see on the right, which is fully populated data that's now usable. And the same thing in this fault data example, you'll see that we have controller, device, diagnostic, and failure mode. So those, all of those objects follow the same process here. The feed result data within in the application is really where all these hydrated records go before they get written out to files. We have a tracked vehicle object. So this section here really just gets into the object-oriented programming. So this is really for your technical people to get an example of how you're sort of applying a little bit of business logic to the feed data. So we have a tracked vehicle, which is aptly named as it represents a vehicle that's being tracked. And it basically contains all the feed data that's received for the tracked vehicles. The tracked GPS data, that stores the GPS data coming in through the log record feed. And for every tracked vehicle, you're going to have the log record data. So you'll have a single one of these tracked GPS data objects. And then we have a tracked diagnostic. So this one's a little bit more complex if you get into the code, start looking at it. And so what it does is it stores all the data coming in for a single diagnostic for a specific tracked vehicle. So you'll see that the tracked vehicle has a list of these diagnostics. So depending on how many you configure in your config file, you'll have that many of these tracked diagnostics for each tracked vehicle. And so as the data comes in, there's logic in there to populate all these things as required. So this is an example of the output that gets produced. This is the log record output. So as I mentioned earlier, what happens in this application is we get all that data, we create those tracked vehicles with the GPS data, log records, fault data. And in this case, to keep it as a simple example, we're just outputting it to CSV files. So this has been just brought into Excel, so that's why it looks a little prettier there. But you can see you've got the log record, it's got your GPS time, your latitude, longitude, speed. The next one here, this is our example of status data. So you can see we've got a diagnostic ID plus the hydrated fields you see on the right of that. So you've got the actual name of the diagnostics. We've got some cranking voltage, engine speed, fuel level percentage, et cetera, with the actual values and units of measure. And then we've got the same thing for the fault data. So in a real application, you wouldn't be dumping this data out to CSV files like this. What you would be doing is taking this data and then writing it to your database, or potentially transforming it into some other API objects to send to a third-party API or your own API. But really, this example solution is a good place to get started, especially if you're new to the SDK, and also if you're API only. Okay, so now what we'll do is we'll get into a deep dive of the code, if we have a few minutes left here. Actually, I'm just kidding, of course. probably not the right audience for that, but for those that are developers and want to get more into this, or if you're representing your company and you have some developers that you think might find some use in this, there's some resources here for you. And these presentations will be available afterwards, so you'll be able to get these links. So the first one there is the actual data-only plan API. Again, this is just for .NET only. So there's a NuGet package there. You can just bring it into Visual Studio to start working with it. Then there's the API example solution. So there's two links there. One's for the source code, and one's for a developer guide. So the developer guide, you can read through that. It'll help you get started with it, you know, understand how to get it set up. Important to note also, in that developer guide, there's also a link to another presentation that has a similar set of slides to the ones I showed you with the objects, but that one actually walks through the business logic within the application. So it's not something that you're necessarily interested here in this audience, but the developers who want to work with it will be able to kind of go through that and get a good understanding of where everything is and what everything's responsible for, which will make it a lot easier to get started rather than having to just start looking at code and trying to figure it out on their own. So definitely if you're trying to get started with it, I'd recommend looking at the developer guide and that other presentation. We also have the customer onboarding starter kit. The source code's available on GitHub as well, and there's a user guide for that. And then we have a couple of other links here. There's the MyGeotab SDK, of course, and also the Marketplace Technical Toolkit. Okay. Turn it over back to Jason here.
Pretty much done here. Yeah. That wraps up the session, actually. If there's any questions, we'll be glad to take them. Yep.
Has API pricing standardized?
Yeah, so I believe platform team is still working out a new tiered system, very similar to the Go devices, a base, a pro, and a pro plus platform or data-only plan for devices. So it should quite well mirror up with what a Go device would typically have. Pricing-wise, we'll have to kind of take back. Yep. Development process? Yeah, so I mean, the documentation actually just got released for how you can enable the services for the deeper add-ins. So we can step through that maybe after the presentation and show you exactly how you can enable those services to develop something like what we saw here. Yeah, so one of our communication models is check the what's new as frequently as possible. That's what we recommend our partners to do, and it's not the friendliest thing. So that's included in the bigger plan of improving the experience, but we don't quite have a solution laid out for that yet with timing. But that's a good thing that I have to take back with me again. Yeah, thank you.
We also have some questions through the app. Check that out. If you have any questions from the audience, please raise your hand and bring you the mic so everyone else can hear your question as well.
Okay, so is there an architecture diagram that can help us to understand how the API-only plan works?
Okay, so basically the object model diagram that I showed you there is something that you could potentially use. There's not really a separate architecture and how it works. It's really just restrictions, essentially, that are in there. So the way you would use the SDK, if you were not using this new tool that's available, would be pretty much the same, except that you're not allowed to do certain things with it. But other than that, there's not really any difference.
So when using Geotab data, should the user developer host the data, or is the data going to be available on the cloud for X amount of time? I think that might be in relation to the deeper add-ins. It depends on how your solution is actually set up. So if you already have data being sourced from some external application or some external system that's added on to, you know, our services, that's data that you would be hosting that would actually be called in real time through an API. That would be our preference. Is there a JavaScript wrapper of the API only APIs?
Okay, so as I mentioned in one of the slides, right now this has been developed for the .NET API only. That's the reason why I also added the other presentation that I referenced. So if you've got some developers that want to get started with it right away, this presentation kind of gives you a very basic overview of how this thing is set up. But then the other presentation, the developer guide, and the presentation will walk through your business logic. So you would be able to get a really good understanding even if you're not a .NET developer. And you know, if you do download the code, there's a lot of code comments in there. So you are able to, in fact, probably figure things out if you wanted to create the same thing for JavaScript or any other platform.
And then a few questions around these deeper add-ins and the APIs available. They are available and officially launched on the SDK as of today. So the Geotab public SDK documentation has the resources that you need. As they are new to everybody, we'll probably kind of handhold that a little bit more and make sure that your questions are addressed in a more timely manner. So feel free to reach out to the integrations team at Geotab for more information. I think there's maybe one other question we can take offline as well.
Right, are there any other questions in the room?
Initially, definitely just JavaScript and exclusive to the map and the trips history pages. The plan is to work off of our partners to decide on what the development path is. So expanding to other supported libraries and languages, as well as different pages within MyGeotab. So for example, I'm a camera company. I want to make sure that the speeding rule in MyGeotab will automatically cause camera data to be captured. So right on the MyGeotab rules page, there can be a button there to enable camera capture. The dashboard is another big one. So everyone knows our dashboard images, they're Excel file driven. They're not always the, you know, cleanest looking or slickest solution. So we can actually open up those tiles to be individual add-ins as well and allow for partners to bring in some context there as well. So there's ideas that we're kind of circulating internally, but we really need the feedback from our partners to kind of dictate the direction that we're going to go with all this.